the Rankin House in Ripley, Ohio, with award-winning author Anne Hagedorn, who also wrote the book Beyond the River. How did the Underground Railroad come into existence?
Well, first, it's an honor to be here, Eckart. Thank you very much. Basically, in general, it was just human nature. When there is oppression, when people are victims of injustices such as human bondage, there will always be people organizing networks to free them. And that happened here in Ripley, Ohio, one of the very earliest networks that would later be known as the Underground Railroad.
Tell us something about Ripley, Ohio, and why it became such a useful destination for slaves escaping across this river, the Ohio River.
Yes, excellent question. I can answer it with three words. One is geography, one is people, and one is the free black settlement known as the Gist settlement north up here. Back in the day, in the antebellum years, the Ohio River at this bend was much more narrow than it is now. It was narrow and it was shallow. And there are, to this day, several creeks that slaves could escape across the river and then continue on the creeks. The dogs would lose their scent because the slave catchers would send dogs after them often. One thing you have to realize is that after crossing the river, they weren't free. They wouldn't be free until they got to Canada. So this network here, this network of individuals who, by the way, came here as early as 1804. The person who founded Ripley, Colonel James Pogue, a colonel from the Revolutionary War, came here from Virginia to free his slaves.
And can you tell us more about the Gist settlement?
Yes. Well, the Gist settlement began in 1818 after a gentleman in Virginia had placed in his will that upon his death, his slaves would be freed, and he left money for them to have a community, 2,200 acres of land north of Ripley. It began in 1818, and it grew and grew and grew, and it was sort of part of the mecca that Ripley became, the combination of the geography, the settlers, very passionate anti-slavery individuals, and the Gist settlement.
For the Underground Railroad network here in Ripley, were there set routes, and if not, what other towns nearby had safe houses and people in contact with the Ripley network?
Cincinnati, of course, was very involved. There were several retailers there who were connected with the network here, and the Lane Seminary, very connected. Oberlin, Ohio, up north, after a landing in Ripley, they would often be taken to Red Oak or Sardinia, Decatur, Russellville, all these towns that are sort of on the way to other safe houses. It was all based on the human connections and like I said, who knew about whom at what particular time,
And so we are here at the house of Reverend Rankin.
Right.
Why was it so important? What was its purpose and what did it symbolize?
In 1829, John Rankin bought property up on this hill, where we're sitting right now, and had a house and a barn built, and he grew all of his own food, which was very important to him. So it was a matter of independence and security, I think. He would put lanterns in the windows as some sort of, code and alerting people that it was either okay or not okay to be coming up here. But also, if you go on the Kentucky side to this day, at night, you put a lantern in one of these windows, you would see it clear over pretty far into that northern border of Kentucky.
The origin of the song is unclear, but the phrase, "This Little Light of Mine," appears published in poetry by 1925 by Edward G. Evans, a writer in Montana. In June 1934, John Lomax and Alan Lomax recorded the earliest known recording of the song when they recorded Jim Boyd of Jacksonville, Texas, singing at the State Penitentiary in Huntsville, Texas. In 1939, Lomax returned to Texas with Ruby Lomax during their Southern States recording trip and recorded the song again. This song and others were sung by a black woman, Doris McMurray, who was imprisoned at Thomas Gorey Unit in Texas and said that she learned the song from her grandmother in Waco.